talk to you about a very important parameter called R0, which essentially decides in a population whether the infection is going to increase or not. And for any disease, that is what you want to know. Whether is the disease going to be there in the population or it's going to go away from it. So people have done lots of work in it. I'm not going to surely cover any of this. Just to give you a feeling about what I mean, why greater than one, how does it work? I'll just show you. Let's say it's an animation again, simple one. So let's say there is one individual, okay? Now this individual is infected, you can see. And on infection, it comes across another three people and it infects three of them, okay? You can see how the whole thing increases very fast. So each of them infect another three, and this is how the number goes up. So it's not a linear, depends on what, if it's one going to two, it's different, but it's not a linear kind of increase. It's a highly nonlinear increase. And you can see that it goes way up very fast. And that's why R0 having a higher value, R0 having a higher value is extremely important for any disease to be able to capture the entire population and make it infected, okay? So within six generations, you can see that the population, the infect number of cases of infected individuals have gone up so much, okay? Starting from one. So it is important. There are several diseases. The R0s have been calculated for several diseases. There are books where you will get bigger lists of diseases. So some of these you know, measles, pertussis, mumps, rubella, diphtheria, polio, okay? So these are all childhood diseases, and the kind of R0 values they have is given here, and the average age at infection is given here, okay? These are all in absence of immunization, please note that almost all of them are immunized at that, by that age, but when there's no immunization, this is what the R0 value is. You can see some of them have very high values. Okay? So 16 to 18 means each individual in a wholly susceptible population infects 60 people in one. Okay? Whereas polio and things or diphtheria, it's less than that, but still it's high. So it is something which is every mathematical epidemiologist wants to calculate from their model to see, and then when you fit, also you have to make sure that you're fit. There's a data set which, a very old data set that people keep using in books and others, which is not, it is kind of a SIR model, except that now the R is dead people. So it's almost like a susceptible infected, and the ones who were infected were dead. So this is on plague, in the 17th century plague. You can see that it shows very similar temporal trend that the SIR model showed, that the susceptible portion population comes down, susceptible part of the population, the infected goes up, and then they go down because all of them are dead. After a while, the entire population is dead. All those who were infected are dead. So this kind of a picture which a typical SIR model gives is quite common in infections which grow and then they die off. Either the individuals are dead or the individuals are completely removed along with some kind of immunity. Now that is a very simple model, even though Dan was telling me the original model of Kermack and McKendrick, the original paper, has a lot more calculations than what I've shown here. So if any of you get a hand on that, you must look at it, especially the ones who are from mathematics, have more interest in mathematics. These are some of the factors that you can include to make your model much more complex. So diseases with vectors, multiple host, immunity loss, that is waning of immunity, carriers who are infectious but asymptomatic, asymptomatic but uninfectious, and more realistic mixing. This more realistic mixing is important because several diseases have different types of mixing properties, and therefore it depends on how the how the disease is propagated. What is the mode of propagation? Does it propagate simply through air and water so that, or does it propagate through contact, or does it propagate through blood transfusion? So for example, for HIV, the major HIV cases in India, the state which had largest number of HIV used to be Northeast in Manipur, and almost all of them were through needle exchange. Okay, so you can see that it is not a random mixing of populations there. It's only those groups who are taking drugs, they are the ones who are getting infected. Then from Manipur it became Andhra Pradesh, and Andhra Pradesh is where I used to work earlier. And there the mode of infection was primarily through sexual contact, because a lot of truck drivers who moved all the way along the major highway cutting across India, north to south, they are the ones who were the carriers, and they are the ones who used to move. Now the state which has largest number of HIV cases is no more Andhra Pradesh, but it's Punjab, where I work now. No relationship should be drawn, but there, wherever I go, it looks that happens. But in Punjab, again, it's the drug menace. It's the needle exchange which has the largest, which is starting the largest number of cases. So it's interesting. More you hear these things, more you would like to know. So obviously, these realistic mixing is a very important part. That surely it's not everybody who's getting HIV, but only the group of young kids who are taking drugs and not taking care of their needles, they are the ones which are having. So one has to put all those things into picture when you want to model these kinds of diseases. Okay, now, why am I here? Okay, so now the basic model of malaria. Let's look at this. I showed this to you earlier, and I told you that the person who made the first epidemiological compartmental model is Ronald Ross, and this is his model. So let's look at that. I chose this because this will give you step by step how the complexity of models go up. So it will give you a good idea about how things happen in general. So this is 1911 model. He had four compartments. Two compartments in humans, two compartments in mosquitoes. You know, in malaria, mosquito plays a major role. It's a vector, so it's very important in the disease etiology. So humans, what would you call this? This human, for the human, what model is it? Is it SIR, SEIR, what model is it? SI? It is a SIS model. Please get this into your head. No point in teaching you very complicated stuff if you don't even understand the basics. It's just no point. I don't believe in that. Okay? So please, so this is a SIS model. And what is for the mosquito? For mosquito, it's a simple SI model, because all infected mosquitoes die. Okay? Whereas all infected humans, for malaria, at least they become better and then they become susceptible. That becoming better could be through their own immunity, could be through drugs. Okay. Now there is interaction, which is given by the red dotted lines. So this interaction is when an infected mosquito bites a susceptible human, it transfers the infection to the susceptible human, then that susceptible human becomes infected and gets the disease. When a susceptible mosquito bites an infected human, it picks up the infection from this human and becomes infected. Clear? This is how it is. Okay? And this, in the process of time, this infected human recovers and goes back to this susceptible class, and in the process of time, infected mosquito goes dead. This is the most basic model without considering anything. And if you can solve these models and understand these, you should be able to, if you are intelligent enough, should be able to do more complex models. Okay. What are the assumptions? Most important. Most important thing. What are the assumptions? If I had enough time, I would have made you tell me the assumption. But anyway, populations are all homogeneously distributed. Okay? It's like that circle with dots as susceptible ones. Now the population is only divided into two compartments, no other compartment, no other disease, no other compartment. Okay? So human population is divided into susceptible and infected, mosquito population is divided into susceptible and infected. Mosquitoes do not recover from the disease, so it doesn't go back. No disease-induced death in human. The time scale that we are looking at is small enough not to consider normal natural death of humans, and therefore the population size is considered to remain constant. Okay? Very simple model. You should be able to write down without my writing here, but let me just write it down. If you remember the SIR model that we just wrote, so what is the rate of change of IH with time, which is given here? It's whatever is coming in from this compartment and whatever is going back to that compartment. So coming in is, of course, IM into SH. Okay. Now, why is it IM into SH? Can you tell me? SH, of course, I understand. This minus gamma IH, you can see it's the recovery rate which goes back. And this can, when does it become infected? It becomes infected only when SH is interacting with IM. Otherwise, where did does the infection come from? So it's the law of mass action, some parameters, some constant parameters, into the multiplication of IM and into SH, susceptible host with infected mosquitoes would give rise to infected host. So therefore, IM into SH is contributing, and minus gamma IH is the one which is taking out. So this is the plus term, this is the minus term. Similarly here, those are the mosquitoes that are getting infected, where an infected human is being bitten by a susceptible mosquito. So IH into SM and some terms, and the ones which are, this is the mu, is the death rate of mosquitoes. Okay? And the population size is considered to be the same. What are these parameters? You have to think about how malaria gets transmitted and put the parameters there. In that, in the earlier model, we had just beta into S into I. Here you have A, B, and M in the place of beta. And what are A, B, M, N? Of course, the mosquitoes have to bite. So there has to be, if the biting rate, there has to be a biting rate of mosquitoes, which means if it bites more, then you are more possibility of getting infection. Okay? B is the infection probability of humans after being bitten by mosquitoes. Not all bites will give you infection, so that is the infection probability. And M is the mosquito to human ratio. If there are more mosquitoes, then there is more infection. If there are less mosquitoes, there are less infection. Okay? So these are three parameters which are contributing into making more infected humans. Okay? I hope that's clear. And gamma, of course, is the recovery rate of humans, which takes it out there. For infected mosquitoes, it's A into C. A, again, the biting rate, and C is the infection probability. So biting rate is common because that's the common rate between human mosquitoes biting humans. But one is the infection probability in humans, that the other one is infection probability in mosquitoes. C is the infection probability of mosquitoes. What it tells you is that not every bite gives rise to infection. There's a probability of infection. So it's that simple. Minus mu m is the death rate. This is the simple model here. Okay, there's nothing else. This is the first model he gave, which was considered to be Ross's model for malaria. What rate is?
Biting rate.
Biting rate is a fixed one.
Is it realistic?
Yeah, you don't know. You know how people find it? You should go to Malaria Research Center. It's now called National Institute of Malaria Research. When they hold workshops, they teach people how to find biting rate. they catch mosquitoes. Now, don't ask me how they catch mosquitoes. They catch mosquitoes and they put it in a box. And that is a box which has a hole with a net in it, closed net. And you're supposed to put your hand through the net inside the box and wait for, say, half an hour or so and count how many bites you get. It's a horrible thing. There was a meeting in January in Vector Control Center of ICMR, Indian Council of Medical Research in Madurai. They were doing same things there also. It all depends. I mean, first of all, you need this because it would, you need it because different mosquitoes might have different biting rates. So it has to go in somewhere. Okay? So species specificity is there. Okay, now all you do is take this and you're going to do it in the afternoon. Please remember that you just give some values of A, B, M, gamma, mu, C, and see with time how is IH and IM changing. So this is how IH is changing. You start with a low value of IH and it stabilizes. So since we have scaled the population to 1, so everything is between 0 and 1. You can write it N also, it doesn't matter. And this is the human and this is mosquito. So both the populations stabilize at a particular value with these parameters. Now, when this model came out, since this was the first so-called first model, everybody liked it, excited about it. But over time, people realized that this model, what it's doing is, within 50 days, after starting the infection, it's reaching the steady state. Okay, but in reality, when people look at malaria cases starting onwards, they see that this rate of reaching the steady state is much slower. And the height at which it stabilized, that also seems very high. So something has to be done to this model so that it replicates the actual data. And whatever you do to that model should be biologically relevant. It took a person like McDonald, who worked for WHO, World Health Organization, about 50 years to come with the next model. Okay? He came up with a model because he wanted to have, and malaria was all over the world, and it was a major health problem. In our country, it killed people, but in most countries, even if it doesn't kill, it really takes away all your working days, and you're sick, and you can't do any work. So being one of the head of World Health Organization, he was very keen in trying to build a mathematical model from which he can develop a control measure. And I think it's one of those models which was very simple. At the same time, it gave it had a predictive value. It gave a measure to control malaria. And that measure was used worldwide over, which had fantastic effect. Okay? So it's a simple model giving rise to realistic control measures is something which McDonald's model is. I'll come to that in the next slide. The only problem is, whenever we do this, we never think of other things. We only think of the information that we are putting in the model. But there are lots of things happen when we do these things. For example, all of you know today that there's hardly any malaria drug left. Yeah, because everything has developed resistance. So what happened was McDonald's control measure was to kill mosquitoes, because he got it from R-naught. Kill the mosquitoes. He used DDT all over the world. Malaria cases came down like this. It was a major victory of mathematical modeling. But within 10 years, all the mosquitoes became DDT resistant. So it doesn't work anymore. Okay. So, but you can't blame him because it wasn't there in the model. Now people, when they make models, they put all these drug resistance, chemical resistance, whole lot of stuff they put in. You have to. But that time it was something new and it was great. Okay. Now, what you would have to do in the afternoon is something like this. Given the ROS model, you have to find out the steady states and you have to find out the stability. Okay? It's Very simple. It's only two variable model. I hope you guys can do it. What is the effect of parameter variation for Ross model? Because that's the other thing you have to do, that you vary parameter and see which parameter has what effect. Can you explain in words why it has effect? So for example, change mosquito to human ratio, okay? Which means you kill the mosquitoes, that's one way, okay? So what has happened is, the older, the black line is for m equal to 2.5, the ratio is lower, and the blue line is ratio is higher. More mosquitoes, lesser mosquitoes, and you can see that the disease is starting faster and stabilizing at a higher value. So it is understandable why it's doing that. Okay, this is the R naught for Ross model. You can calculate that again from the equation. You can, this simulation is used, these are the parameters that have been used. You can calculate the R naught also, given those parameters, to see what value it takes. Now you reduce, so what happened is if you double the mosquito to human ratio, the reduction of final prevalence is by 5% or 6%, okay? That's what your result is. Now you want to change mosquito mortality rate. All you're trying to see is, without touching the humans, can we reduce the disease? That is all you're trying to do. So you're touching, first addressing only the mosquito parameters. So first you address ratio of mosquito to human, then you change mosquito mortality rate, okay? Mu, well, you have doubled it here from 0.05 to 0.1. And when you have doubled the mosquito mortality rate, it has come down only this much, from blue to black. So certainly, you can also do something which we did later. You can do a, what is known as sensitivity analysis of the parameters. It's a method with which, if you have multiple parameters, you can find out which are the parameters that the model is most sensitive to. Otherwise, no point in managing every parameter which hardly has any effect. Okay? That analysis, is mathematical analysis, can be done. So all these arsenals mathematicians have can be applied to good sense. I don't know how many of them apply it. Okay. So reduction in final prevalence is only 2% here. So obviously, if you have to choose between this and this, you will choose that. Because between the two, that's better. Okay. So this is what you have to figure out, that if you change, now you change the biting rate. So if you change the biting rate from 0.1 to 0.2, you're increasing. If you increase the biting rate from 0.1 to 0.2, you see how fast it goes up and stabilizes also higher. This is much slower. The infection is building up much slower. And that is about 9 to 10%. Okay. So biting rate till now seems to be the most sensitive one, most important one in terms of if you want to change anything. All right, so this is the kind of thing you will do in the afternoon, and please do it. Otherwise, you'll go back and learning nothing almost. I mean, it won't retain in your head. Okay, let's look at McDonald's model. So, what did he do? He took the same model for humans, just two compartments, SIS, but he changed the mosquito compartments. Okay. Well, why did he do that? Because everybody knew that from going from an infected, susceptible mosquito to infected mosquito, it takes about 10 days for the parasite to go through this process. Okay? And parasite actually develops in the mosquito gut, and that's how it takes some time. So which means it's infected to the, it's exposed to the infection, but it's still not infected, because if this mosquito buys a susceptible human, it doesn't get the disease. But only if an infected mosquito bites a susceptible human, it gets the disease. Okay? So it has now become SEI model. From SI model, it has now become SEI model. So the only thing that McDonald did was, two things he did. One is he increased the compartment number in the mosquito group, and he also introduced a time delay, which is related to the latent period of the parasite development in mosquito gut. Everything else was same as Ross's. Okay? But this was biologically realistic. This is how biologically realistic information goes into models. What does it do to the results? Okay, here is the model. You can compare it with the Ross model and see. So you can see for IH nothing has changed. Because nothing is changing. It is still getting, SH is getting infected by IM, IH is getting infected by SM. Nothing has changed for it. So the first term is ABM, IM, SH. So the IH equation has not changed. But now there's another equation for EM and one equation for IM. So the EM equation has that there are mosquitoes coming from this compartment to this compartment, which is same as what was there earlier, and for IM, now it's here. And then there is a number of them are going into this compartment, that's why it's a minus, but that is after a certain number of days, which is the delay period, okay, latent period. That's why it is not T, but T minus tau. So only whatever was there 10 days before, those are the ones which are becoming infected. All the exposed mosquito within 10 days are no more not becoming infected. Okay, so that's why it's T minus tau of IH and T minus tau of SM. And here is a term which tells you that these mosquitoes die, so here is a death term for both of them now, and this infection decays with respect to tau. Within this time, mu is the death rate. Within this time, t mu to the minus mu to the power t is there's an exponential decrease because of death. So this is how I've just written the Ross model here. You can see nothing has changed here. It's only this is the DIM. So the DIM has changed. I'll have both of them together. So R0 becomes this. Where is it? R0 becomes this. It's very similar to the Ross. Ross's R0 was this. McDonald's R0 is very similar, along with this exponentially decreasing term, which is with respect to the time delay that has been included here, okay, which is the latent period. How does the simulation looks? How does IH and IM change? They change the same thing. They grow and they stabilize. But you can see there's a lot of difference between the two, and this, even though this goes close to one, but not as close. But IM certainly stays much less. This is easier to see. Let me show you this one. This is for Ross, and this is for McDonald. So this is a SIS and SI model. This is a SIS and SEI model. Equations you can compare, and the R0 you can compare. If you put in these values, you see that the R0 in Ross is much higher compared to the R0 in McDonald. So this itself tells you that introduction of this compartment of E and the time, the delay, that latent period has already reduced the infectivity, the R0 of the ability for the disease to grow, okay, and where the terms are coming. So how does the simulation results look? That is here. So this is Ross, human, infected human. This is Ross, infected mosquito. This is McDonald, infected human. This is McDonald. Now what you see is they are not only reaching lesser fully infectious states, the total number is less, much less for mosquitoes. They're also growing slower. And this is what the data that people collected of growth of the disease, growth of malaria in a population, is also much slower than what Ross had predicted. So through inclusion of another compartment and the latent period, these two things have been achieved. That one, the disease is now growing slower, and the mosquito stabilized value is much less than what it is. So you can see that what kind of changes, biologically relevant changes, are included in model, what are the mathematical forms that are used for it, and how do they get into a model and change the behavior. You can find out the steady states of this if you can. You can choose a fixed tau value and look at this. Now, how I showed you what happens when parameters are changed for Ross model, let's take a look at when how does it compare with the McDonald model? So there are three pictures here. One is for changing M, mosquito to human ratio, another for changing biting rate, and the other for changing death rate of mosquitoes, okay? RR is for Ross, MCMC is for McDonald, and all the three. You can see if you double the mosquito to human ratio, then we have seen this RR result earlier, and McDonald also similar result. It also, the variation is similar. For changing A, the biting rate, it shows much wider difference. And for changing mu, it shows much wider difference, okay? Whereas in RR, it's only this much of. So looks like changing mu has a lot more effect in this model, that is the mosquito death rate, and that was actually important because that based on that only they made the decision to spray DDT all over, okay? So in this case, when I change mosquito to human ratio, the reduction in final prevalence, humans were only 5.6%. In McDonald's, it was almost close to 9 to 10%. When I changed biting rate, this was 9.6%. This was double, 18%. And for changing mortality rate, you can see the difference. It was only 2% there, and it's 11%. Comparing these values, and after thinking that what is going to be the easiest way to regulate, to reduce the infected humans, they decided that, so if you do a stability analysis, a sensitivity analysis also, you get similar results. But just by sensitivity analysis, nothing but they do the same things, but in a much smaller steps, and there are criteria for choosing. So the effect of parameters, A is maximum for us, then mosquito to human ratio, then mosquito death. But for McDonald, biting rate, then mosquito death, and then mosquito to human ratio. But you can see all of them are related to, you can do for the other, I mean, maybe in the afternoon you can do for the other parameters and see they don't have as much effect as the mosquito related parameters have. So therefore, this is what was chosen for elimination of malaria from the world, by killing the mosquitoes, okay? So that is the basis of the WHO's decision to spray DDT all over the world, and it really, really helped. Today we are out of malaria, one of the reasons is that, but there are other repercussions for that. For the basic reproductive ratio, you can see that Ross model has a much higher value, and this one has a lower value. You should be able to calculate all these. Don't tell me that I can't calculate e to the power minus mu t, tau. If I give you mu and tau, you should be able to calculate. I've been having this problem with students who don't know how to calculate log and exponential or anything, unless they have internet. I'm finding it very difficult. It tells me how old I've grown. Okay, I showed you two basic models of malaria, the Ross model and the McDonald model. And malaria is a disease which has been worked on maximally because it has been a long-term disease. It has been in this world for so long that everybody wants to model it. Everybody wants to find out ways of, it's not a lethal disease, but it's a very important disease. So here is a picture I'm showing that how mathematical models have changed over time for malaria alone. So this is from one of our reviews. Here is the one, these are the only two I talked about, okay? These are the basic models. The third model which built upon these two was written by Anderson and May, it was in 1991 so this is not in terms of importance, this picture. This picture is in terms of adding compartments. The complexity of compartments. You can see that here it was only SIS and SI, here it was SIS and SEI. Here if this compartment was introduced in humans also, because the malaria parasite actually spends some time inside humans also when it develops. So this E compartment, exposed compartment, was included in Anderson and May's model. So it became a SEIS, and this is SEI. There are lots of offshoot models, many, 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 and there people have included migration, people have included environmental factors, people have included socioeconomic factors, age, structure, then this is including some subdivisions among age, among infected, which are which have a different kinds of quality. These are the models which are later models. So you can see immunity functions, age, immigration, socioeconomic factors. So many factors can be included. Vaccination, all sorts of things can be included in these models. And what we have given here are only the compartments that have been introduced in the model. So the person who was asking me whether you can add compartment, of course you can add. You have to have a good reason to add. So if you have a reason to add, add it and see what happens. This is SEIRS. Okay, and this R is special, is new. Okay. Everybody is sticking to SEI. That hasn't changed much because that's all it has. It doesn't have anything. So these are the classes of models that one can make. In fact, all the models you will hear from now onwards will be much more complicated because nobody makes a model of this kind anymore. They're already made of the McDonald's and Ross type because they are already there. Now you want to make it more realistic. And when you want to make it realistic, what are the features you put in? How do you put in the assumptions? And what does it look like? I'm going to now show you rest of the time how one can take mathematical, how you can develop mathematical models by considering many basic processes of infection between hosts and how you can give general predictions from the prevalence, about the prevalence data and how do you match with in the number of data points that you can collect from the population. Surely I won't go too much into detail, but I'll tell you what has been done because these are all work that is being done. If I were only teaching this, then I would have probably gone right from the beginning on the paper. Okay, so this is a detailed model with human and mosquito. Okay, and then I will show you how to reduce or simplify this detailed model into slightly lesser complexity and by replacing the mosquito compartments, because in reality, counting mosquitoes are out of question. Okay, so let's see how one goes about it, and I'll show you. The first thing, don't get scared by, is the first thing you have to draw is the compartments, because your compartment model should be based on compartments. So what compartments would you look at? Here are the compartments. Okay. Now, this work was done by Sandeep, who now works with Public Health Foundation of India, and Ramroop, both my co-workers. Ramroop is, Sarkar is now at the National Chemical Laboratory in Pune. So let's look at the compartments first. Okay. Some things which are very well known: susceptible, exposed, infected. All we have done is we have taken the exposed. And then we have said, this is malaria, okay? So you can have individuals who are infected, but they don't show fever. And you can have individuals which show fever. Both are infected though, okay? So now I have S, E, I, but I now has two subcompartments, infected and symptomatic and asymptomatic. How many compartments in mosquitoes? Only three, S-E-N-I, okay? Susceptible, exposed, and infected. So the compartments are done. Let's look at the arrows, because that tells you the interactions. Let's look at the red arrows first. Okay, let's look at the black arrows first. So here it's straightforward. This is the birth rate of mosquitoes. This is the death rate. This should keep the numbers same. So mosquitoes are born, then they become exposed through infection, and that exposed class becomes infected after spending a certain amount of time. So these black arrows show this. Everywhere there are these small arrows, which tells you that at every class, mosquitoes are also dying. So mu m is both death rate and birth rate. So mu m is susceptible mosquitoes also die, exposed mosquitoes also die, infected mosquitoes also die. Okay. So this is for this, simple. Let's see what about here. So the susceptible humans, obviously there is a birth rate here. Susceptible humans, this compartment gives rise to the exposed humans on infection through infected mosquitoes. The exposed humans then give rise to two infected compartments. So here are these arrows. And these infected humans also have a traffic between them, because asymptomatic, either through other mosquito bites or just through levels of infection, can go from asymptomatic to symptomatic compartment, okay? And they can die also, okay? Now, so this is a two arrows where it says the symptomatic compartment individuals can show is asymptomatic condition, and asymptomatic ones can also get into the symptomatic compartment. So there are arrows going on both sides. Asymptomatic ones can also recover and get into the susceptible compartment. Symptomatic ones can also recover and get into the susceptible compartment. This can be done in two ways, either normal recovery or through drug-induced recovery. All that goes into. Here are the, let's get into the colored dotted arrows. Dotted arrows tells you infection route. When what the red ones are, how humans are getting infected. Infected mosquito, when bites a susceptible human, gives rise to exposed humans. Okay, so this red arrow. Infected mosquitoes, when they bite a asymptomatic one, also can give rise to symptomatic ones. So asymptomatic to symptomatic can happen through more infection, bites of mosquitoes, okay? So there are two ways this compartment can have individuals coming in. The blue dotted line tells how mosquitoes become infected. So susceptible to exposed mosquitoes can happen when these susceptible mosquitoes bite either of them, because both are harboring infection. Either of the compartment humans, when they bite, this line goes from susceptible to exposed. There are lots of stuff written here, parameters. They are given here. Mu H and mu M, known per capita death rate of humans and mosquitoes. Birth and death rate have been kept constant. Then comes rate of transmission from susceptible to exposed class in humans. Here is sigma. It was something like what beta was when we looked at it earlier. That is sigma. Susceptibility to clinical disease is eta. So that makes it clinically symptomatic disease. And 1 minus eta goes to asymptomatic. Okay. 1 by gamma is the mean duration of the exposed class of humans. So there is a certain amount of time it stays in the exposed class before it becomes infected. Probability of direct recovery from symptomatic disease, here is beta, okay? So recovery probability. Rate of recovery from asymptomatic disease, that one. R is the rate of recovery from symptomatic disease. This is RS. So beta into RS is the total recovery from symptomatic to susceptible humans. Then mu m I talked about when I said mu m. This is important, lambda m, that is rate of transformation from susceptible to exposed class in mosquito. Here it is. So when a susceptible mosquito bites these infected humans and makes that particular mosquito go into the exposed class, that is given by, that transformation rate is given by lambda m. So you can see how many parameters are there. How many variables are there? It's no more as simple as it could be. This is certainly not the best model. This is certainly not the simplest model, or not the most complex model. Now, I want you to just look at this. This is the basic assumption of the mathematical model. This is just to tell you that at least few pages in the paper you have to give in the paper to tell What are the assumptions of giving those, writing those terms? Especially if you're trying to publish your work in a journal where malariologists are going to read and not mathematical modelers are only going to read. Doesn't matter, even mathematical modelers in epidemiology are so practical these days that you have to justify why are you writing these terms. So basically these are the assumptions. There are seven assumptions. It tells you why you chose this kind of a functional form for rate at which individuals go from susceptible class to exposed class, okay? So rate of transfer. This is one of the first terms in Ross's and McDonald's model. Here what it says is, it's not only dependent on all these terms, M, A, and B, which are all those different mosquito-related terms, it's also dependent on age. Now this is very important, because most of the data on which models have been based in malaria, these are the data which have been collected from Africa. Fortunately, most African data are collected by European countries, not by Africans themselves. That, like us, they also don't have all the infrastructure to do that. But whereas a lot of French, German, English, and all those people have their institutes and collaborations there, and hopefully they collect very clean data. From there, they have shown, and for every malaria model, you have to prove that your model does that. They have shown there's a strong age dependence of malaria in humans. Most of the time, the symptomatic disease is seen in children. Adults all have the infection, they are all endemic, okay? But they don't show the disease. They're not symptomatic. So here is a term which is, these all come from fitting data also, that tells you A has something to do with disease. A0 is half, if you draw the curve, then the length, the age at which half of the, where is A0 here? Yeah. A is the age of the human host, and A0 is the constant, represents the age at which half the total increase in exposure. So one has to include all these kinds of things. So there is this time included, proportion of exposed class giving the symptomatic disease is included, reinfection is included because symptomatic to asymptomatic is through reinfection, immunity is included. This is a very important term because why don't adults show the disease whereas children show? Because adults are already have already experienced the infection and they develop what is known as the parasite immunity. So there are three types of immunity that is included in this model. Clinical immunity comes from the mother. Parasite immunity comes, so maternally acquired immunity comes from the mother. Parasite immunity comes through exposure. And clinical immunity is something which a child actually acquires partly from clinical immunity comes from basic exposure and something else I've forgotten. I'll check that out. Okay, so there are three types of immunity that has been included here. So those terms will all go in and you have to justify how those functional forms are written. Here are another few of them where how do you write this functional form, which is the recovery rate from symptomatic to susceptible class, back from symptomatic disease to susceptible class is RS. So in 1 minus beta is the one which I go to the symptomatic. So you have these fractions in them, and then you can write down this. This is the fraction, this is the rate, which is not only dependent on the fraction of symptomatic people who get treatment, also those who don't get treatment into rho and S. Rho S and rho T are the recovering without treatment and with treatment. So all these things are included. So this is, when you write down, before you write down the model equations, you have to say how you have written down all those model equations, not going through them in very many details, because there's no need. This is more to tell you that how things are changed when you are writing a more complicated model. This is an important parameter, which tells that rate at which susceptible mosquitoes move to exposed class from susceptible class. It's also some kind of rate of infection. That will depend on several different other parameters, the probabilities of mosquito infection upon biting, symptomatic and asymptomatic. So symptomatic and asymptomatic. Okay, so all those are included with the rate constant, etc. Then comes the latent period. So the mosquito survival during the extrinsic latent period is given through one of these. They are always exponentially decreasing term. So that's what it is. The latent period is tau, mu m is the death or birth rate. Now with all these numbers available, some of these numbers are available, latent periods are all available from experiments, okay? You include all these things into your model and write down the model. Surely it won't look a clean, nice Ross model type of a stuff. This is how the model looks. Anybody who's interested in the detail of the model can look up the paper, which is written here. So what am I calculating on the left-hand side? How does the number of individuals in the susceptible human class change, exposed human class change, infected symptomatic class change, infected asymptomatic change? Similarly for mosquitoes, susceptible, exposed, and infected mosquitoes, how do they change? These are all different terms that have been included by considering all these different types of stuff, assumptions that I talked about. For example, when does, let's just look at one of them. Rest, you, if you are interested, you can look at the paper. What contributes to increasing the number of susceptible humans in this model? Surely birth, so that's the term. This is the term which is coming from infected symptomatic humans on getting drug treatment, getting back to susceptible class. This is the one. Okay. This is asymptomatic ones becoming, getting cured and going back to the susceptible ones. And these are all positive terms. Okay. These are the negative terms because these are the individuals which are becoming infected and going from SH to EH. That would depend how many of SH are infected through the infected mosquitoes and plus the death of humans. Okay? This is how you go about developing a model. You always have added term and you always have negative terms which will say this is how the numbers reduce, this is how the numbers go up. All these are developed based on similar thing that has been told in numbers. Here again, very similar. The number of susceptible mosquitoes would depend on the birth and they will go into the infected, exposed class depending on how this lambda m is the infective rate of infection on of the susceptible mosquito that it's getting infected and going into, and this is the death rate, okay? So this is how it goes. Now what do you do with a model like this? Of course you can do a lot of mathematical analysis. Let me just show you a little bit of what has been done, because I'm not going to show that to you in experiments, sorry, in the class. But just to give you an idea that this is directly from the paper, I hope you can see, yeah. So there are two things you do when you have a model like this. Of course, if you are going to publish in a non-mathematical journal, then all the analysis that is being done will go into appendix. Sorry, but that's how it is. If you are publishing in a mathematical journal, then at least they remain on the paper. So since we published in Bulletin of Mathematical Biology, it remained in the paper. Whatever we published in Malaria journal, everything went into appendix. Very sad, but that's how it is. So when you have a model, you find out the positivity and boundedness of the model and of the solution. So you go through all these. Many of you probably won't know how to do it. Some of you would know how to do it. I'm just giving you an idea that what gets done so that it's considered to be good. So you show that it is bounded, you show that it is positive. Then you find out the equilibria, which is the steady states, okay? And then you find out the reproductive number, which is very important for any model. So then you see that when the, it's such a complicated model, so there are multiple equilibria, but you will look only at the positive ones. You see, first see whether you have a disease-free equilibrium point and find out its existence. So you do that, and you show that this is exactly one unique equilibrium point. So all these things are mathematical work. I'm not even going through it. Then you have an endemic equilibrium point, which means a fixed point where all the compartments are there, are present, has greater than zero. So you actually, one has to calculate that. And from that model, you can see that this is a mathematical calculation. This is not numerical. It is not after putting in values going to XPP auto and finding out this steady state, okay? This requires work. And there are specialized people to do these kinds of work who are experts mathematicians. So you can see that how each of the equilibrium points had dependence on so many parameters, okay? And there are some parameters were not even there in our model, K1, K2, because now these are functions of parameters, okay? So you can see that K1, K2s are themselves parameters and they're related. Of course, we couldn't solve it fully because it wasn't easy to solve completely. But whatever it is, one could get at least the steady state in some closed form so that one could get some idea about it. Then you have to find out the basic reproduction number, that is the R0. And for this one, it took us quite some time to do it because none of us are really experts, but it is. There are words here which you haven't studied, so I'm not even going to talk about it. So there are different types of methods that one uses to find out the basic reproductive rate, and this is what is done. So let me not even get into it. There's just too few of you who might think that what is being done, what is being told to you is very basic. What gets actually done is much more complex. This is the expression for the R0 that one gets for this particular model. It's not at all as simple as the Ross model and McDonald. You can see that there are lots more terms here. To find out what are the parameter values for which it will be greater than 1 or equal to 1 or less than 1 is not an easy job. So there's a lot of work here that mathematicians do. You have to prove that your endemic equilibrium point exists for when R0 is greater than 1 and is unique. You do stability analysis for this, which goes on for pages, and then you have to find out the stability around the disease-free equilibrium for different kinds of R0 values. You prove theorems that there are certain conditions that hold for, we could prove it only for tau equal to 0, that is the latent period equal to 0. For tau non-zero, it wasn't at all easy to do. Etc., etc., etc. The model was done also with tau not equal to 0, but it was completely numerical in that case. So all these necessary sufficient conditions, asymptotic stability, etc., all were done. And here is some result. So I'm not going to, let me just get out of this. Then you go into numerical study because that's all you get from mathematical study. It's so complicated, there are so many parameters that you don't get any feeling of what is coming out. So every kind of study has its own value. It is very important to understand where the value is and use all of them whenever you need. It is not that one type of study is better than the other type, it's just that one type of study gives you some information, the other type of study gives you nothing. We were studying mathematical models, especially epidemiological models, and then I also showed you how to build or what goes into building a particular model, what kind of information are required, how do you put them in mathematical form, and such stuff. Then I told you that there are different kinds of work you can do once you have set up a mathematical model. You can solve it mathematically. You can find out, you can do analysis, mathematical analysis, to figure out whether it has any kind of solutions. If it has solutions in terms of finding steady states. If it has steady states, does it have any disease-free steady state, which is what you would look for? You want your population not to have disease. So what are the conditions on those steady states? What are the conditions on the parameters? So these are very important information you get out of the steady states. And if you can do a local stability analysis of the steady states, then it will tell you whether those are attracting or repelling, whether there is periodicity, what is it? And you saw that that complicated model we built, which looked so complicated, it had no bifurcation at all. It was always stable. Okay, so if you're looking for interesting dynamics, sometimes all this work does not give you all that, but that's not why you make models. You make models to see how reality is, and if you can put in that reality into mathematical expressions, which would represent the disease that you're trying to study. So that is what is some kind of modeling technique. It is mathematically, mathematics is used, or related computation is used to study. So these are mathematical models which incorporate processes, that process details to understand disease prevalence within the, and then try to predict from there. What I'm going to do now in few slides, and obviously it won't be very detailed, is database studies where you don't have a model, you don't know anything. You don't know biology, you don't know any stuff. That is what is that is how most of the time the predictive instruments are made and used by public policymakers, because they don't want to get into that kind of complicated models. Okay? They have data of disease incidence and they want to be able to predict what is going to happen next week. Okay? So there, what they do is they analyze the prevalence data of a disease and they look for patterns, and if that pattern can be used to predict what is coming next. Okay? And all they have in their hand are climatic or environmental variables. For example, rainfall, humidity, etc. Okay? So these are called data-based studies or mathematical and statistical models. Mathematics is everywhere. Whether it comes under statistics or something else, that's a different matter. But you'll need it, except that the approach is different. One approach is more based on reality. The other approach is more based on some sort of ability to predict patterns in data. Of course, as I mentioned earlier, the final aim is to be able to unify model studies, that is mathematical model studies, with real data. And I showed you one example in the morning, and I'm showing you now one example where there is no mathematical model, but still you are able to predict. Okay, so we'll take the same data set, the one which you have used, so that you get a feeling that the same data set can be modeled differently. And depending on who's doing, what do they want to do? That is how they go about. So this is the data set we made, a mathematical model of malaria. And this is the data set we validate our model using this particular data set from malaria cases in Bangalore. I told you that there is some kind of a trend here. So the trend part always is taken care of. Let's see what do we do. So how to understand and explain disease prevalence? Pattern, so here you are looking at the pattern of prevalence when you do not have a mathematical model. So what do you do? And this is what is done most of the time, by the way. Okay. So what we do, what we have done in a small piece of work, is that there are many, many statistical methods that you can use. Whenever you are trying to understand whether two variables are related or not, in very basic statistics they tell you that you try and regress them, one against the other, which means you try and find out whether one depends on the other. So there are methods, linear regression methods, nonlinear regression methods. What do? They find out if X is dependent on Y. If it's a linear regression, they will write an equation of a line, Y equals MX plus C, or Y equals A plus BX, where X is the independent variable and Y is the dependent variable. So in this context, my number of malaria cases are the dependent variable, and everything else it depends on are the independent variable. If I see that my data is something where if I change a particular variable x, my y changes, then I will try linearly, then I will try and put it into a linear form. I will try and model it using a linear equation. Obviously, the data doesn't look like that. You saw the data, it goes, keeps going up and down and all that. So obviously, linear regression is not going to be useful. So what do? You use nonlinear regression methods. There are many methods, very complex, some of them. So you use nonlinear regression modeling methods. There are several names. One of the one which I'm going to talk about is called response surface method. They're quite similar with small chain differences. I'm not going to tell you the details about the methods, except that I'm going to use it and show you that this is one way of doing things. Okay? Anybody who wants to do it, they have to learn. These days, with very good statistical software, if you know R, if you know any of the largest, Statistica, and it's a big stat, Minitab and all that, they all will have these methods coded in them. Of course, I would suggest that you understand the method first, read it up, and then use it. But since usage has become much easier than what we, in our time, because all those were not there, we used to sit down and write it with hand. But now people can use any of the software tools and use the methods to it, exactly the way you're doing. Some of you are using MATLAB to solve the differential equation. Some of you are actually using a small piece of code like Runge-Kutta fourth order algorithm or something like that. When you use a small piece of code, Runge-Kutta fourth order, you know exactly what you're doing. When you're using MATLAB, you don't even know what MATLAB is doing. So I always suggest that you at least know what you're doing, then you use MATLAB. Understand what ODE45 does, and then only you use it. Just blindly using a software tool makes no sense. You will definitely get into trouble. So all those background reading, nobody teaches you. You have to learn it yourself. Nobody taught us also. Okay. So as I mentioned here also, there are several different types of data sets were taken from different cities. What I have additionally shown you here is that both Bangalore and Chennai, actually, even though they are almost on the same level, but they belong to different ecological climatic regions, okay? So this one is called tropical wet, this one is called semi-arid. This is semi-arid, the light part. The dark brown part is semi-arid, and this is wet and dry. Okay? So obviously, when you are having if you are looking at malaria in both cases, the climate definitely is going to influence it. And we were trying to see how to go about with different types of data sets. Anyway, I'm going to show you only with one. So even if both the cities are in tropical region, tropical climate, the rainfall patterns are quite different. And therefore, you can put two different climate zones and you can study them. You can, since this is a statistical model, you're going to use external climatic variables. Different importance of variables will be in these two cases. Okay. So what do? You take the data set. Along with the data set, your data set is the total malaria cases. I have shown this earlier. This is the data set we are looking at. Total malaria cases, you want to know if this is my response variable, which means this is my dependent variable, what are the independent variables that is causing this kind of a dependency? Obviously nonlinear, but how do you go about it? Okay. Now, there's no question of any immunity function, anything here. The question is, this is my dependent variable, and my independent variables are all from my environment. I don't know anything else. So these are the independent variables, which are what? They are rainfall, temperature, humidity, and population size. They are both climatic and demographic. This is what we are going to take as independent variable. This is my dependent variable. How is this pattern coming out from these patterns? That is what I have to figure out. So climate variables, rainfall, temperature, humidity, and demographic variable is population. So let's look at it, what you do. Actually, the method is quite simple, but doing is not very simple, but not completely very undoable also. So let me see the data set when they are plotted on the same. This, when you plot them on the same, just to see whether there are some patterns that you can check that what is dependent on what. So what you can see is, I don't know what these are. Anyway, why am I at central? Okay, so the green line is rainfall. Okay, green line is rainfall, and these white bars are the total malaria cases. And then the magenta line is average temperature. This is a seaside city, so average temperature doesn't change much. This is average humidity, the orange, and the rainfall I talked about. And there must be somewhere a population line. Now, what do you see when you plot them together? You see that as you have peaks of malaria incidence, the number of cases, they are peaking, and these are generally within a year, the peaks are within a year. It's almost similar or a little lagging behind the rainfall pattern, okay? So certainly the rainfall has, and along with rainfall, the average humidity also oscillates a little bit, so this is also oscillating. Somehow the average temperature doesn't have too much of effect, it's there. So how does one go about it? One looks at the, so there are total 59 data points, okay? So first you want to make a model which will fit this data. And then you want to use the same data, you can't use the same data, but part of the same data to validate your model, okay? So what we do is, we take for 80% of the data, that is 48 data points out of 59, to fit the model. And rest of them, another 10, 11 data points, we leave for validation. So we take from here to here for fitting the model, and we leave some of them for validation. So so this is how one goes about after getting the data. Longer the data set you have, better it is. Smaller the data set you have, more noise it will be. It's not going to be very good. But then who gives you long data sets? But at least that is how it is. So what are the steps that you use to do, to find out what are the dependent variables? What are the independent variables? Dependent variable is the total number of malaria cases. And you have the climatic variables as those which can be independent variables. So let's look at this list and see whether we can get some idea about it. First of all, we want to know whether there is any correlation within the data set. Okay? So I want to do autocorrelation study. What it does is whether the total malaria cases are related to each other. They're correlated with earlier cases. So you can do autocorrelation, which is pretty straightforward, and you can find out whether the response variable, that is the total malaria cases, are dependent on each other. If they are dependent, is it dependent only in the earlier step or earlier to earlier step? It all depends on how the disease, how many months or how many days the disease takes to grow to a level where it comes out as a disease, for example, the latent period and all that. So they all play a role, but you're not considering them as latent period and all that. All you're considering is, let me see that if I have monthly data point, does my this month's data, total malaria case, depend on my last month's data, which generally should actually, okay? Because if last month was very large, then next month tends to be large, but then they are also dependent on whether there was mosquitoes, whether there were rainfall, whether it was humid and all sorts of things. So one does autocorrelation on the data set, okay? And you find out whether there's any autocorrelation in the data set that you have looked, you have the total malaria case. Then you have several different climatic variable, rainfall, humidity, temperature, etc. You want to know whether they are all independent or there is some correlation between them. You might always think that humidity is correlated to rainfall. So why do I consider them as two independent variables? So you do correlation studies among the independent variables, okay? And whether the correlation is linear or nonlinear, that you study using the residual plots. You look at the residual plots. What are they? They are some kind of a variation from the average that you can see, whether that variation is uniform across all the data points or whether the variation is not uniform across all the points. There is a certain shape that you can get in the residual plot, which tells you whether it's linear or nonlinear correlation. Okay? So all these are actually taught in a biostatistics course. Unfortunately, statistics is not a subject which is taught in both physics and mathematics. Beyond probability, most of them think there's nothing in this world to teach. But in biology, they teach. But I'm not very sure whether everybody gets the idea, because by then they're all wired to do other things. So, but it is very important to understand these things, like dependency, linearity, etc., collinearity. So after doing all these two steps, you shortlist the final independent variables. So maybe the humidity goes away because rainfall is more important and things like that. Once you shortlist the independent variable, you fit your model. So this is just another kind of nonlinear regression method, which is a kind of experimental optimization procedure. They generally used it in chemistry. We used it for epidemiology data set to optimize the output, that is the response variable, with respect to the input independent variables. Okay, so there's standard ways. I'll show you the expression how you do it, so you will see. Once you do that, you remove the redundant terms in a systematic manner. I'll tell you how we do that. And then you have a model where all the terms have been taken. You have another model where some terms have been taken away as redundant terms. Then you compare the original model with the reduced model, and you want to know which is better. And to know which is better, you use certain criteria. This is a very, very common criteria that is used, AIC, it's called Akaike's information criteria, between the initial models and reduced model. Essentially, it depends on the on the residual plots, actually. How different are these variables with respect to the actual data point? It uses information theory, the typical Shannon information theory. And so we use that to decide which model is better than the other. Okay? Then you fit the reduced model to predict the data parts of data that you haven't used to make the model. Now you use your model to predict that part of the data, whether it does or not, may or may not. Okay? So it's actually, we do a lot of these when I teach biostatistics, I teach them how to do it, but we do linear ones, but nonlinear ones, the methods are just the same. Okay, so what are the independent variables that have been chosen? First of all, you can see that there was autocorrelation found in the data set, that TMC at the earlier stage is influencing TMC at the next stage. Because if earlier time point the total malaria cases were large, then there's a tendency for the next step also to be high, because there were more people having the disease. So that becomes one of the independent variables, okay? Then average temperature, rainfall, and also temperature at the, it's called at lag one, which means the earlier time step. Why do you think this is important? Along with average temperature, you also have average temperature at the earlier step. Because if you remember, these pathogens, especially malaria parasite, they spend close to about 20 days between two hosts, the vector and the host, to grow. So the number of cases that you are seeing now is actually by the pathogens which came into the picture about 20 days earlier, which means close to a month. So the influence of the earlier time step, and that depends on the temperature is a major determinant of growth of these parasites, pathogens, okay? So the, if 20 days back the temperature was very conducive to their growth, then that gives much more important, gets much more importance than the temperature today because they are growing, okay? So that's why the earlier steps, time points temperature at that time is important along with average temperature now. So these correlations and autocorrelations can be found from the data set, of temperature, rainfall, because everywhere you are having rainfall at every month, temperature at every month, you can do autocorrelation, you can do correlation and figure these things out. You can see that humidity has gone out from this list because it depends on rainfall. Okay? So that is how you reduce them. Yeah, but TMC at lag 1 is the data point at that particular time.
So is it not correlated with the average temperature?
So TMC at lag 1 will be correlated by the average temperature of the lag 1's earlier. The earliest step of that, the earliest step.
Average temperature, what will be
there at this time? So I'll show you that this is what seemed to have influence. Now which one has more than what, that you have to figure out. Maybe this one has more than that. You'll see that, okay? So you take 59 data points for model fitting and rest for validation. Now how do you write the model? That is the whole idea to show you this. Since it's a nonlinear regression model, you need to decide till what nonlinearity are you going to go. First of all, let's do only two, okay? So you write an expression like this, okay? Here is your dependent variable, total number of malaria cases, and here are the dependents. You see there's no biology here. No immunity function, no growth function, nothing. Simple, y equals a plus bx plus cx squared plus dxy. So we are taking only second order model because that's the first nonlinearity you can think of. If you want to be more accurate or if it's required, you can go to third order. You can take a plus bx plus cx squared plus dx cubed. You are making your life more difficult, that's all. So you take, this is your model, by the way, that's all. It's just a polynomial of second order, expression, algebraic expression, where the particular independent variables, their effect is taken, the square of their effects is taken, and the importance of the multiplication of these variables are taken. So that's all. Now, the whole reason I don't like this kind of doing the modeling is because there is no biology in it. But then what do you do when you don't know biology? Not everything, all biology is known. If it works, it should be useful, okay? So what is I going one from n? If there are n data points, in this case n is 59. So for all data points, all these terms come in, okay? So this is what you have to write. This is the algebraic equation you have to fit with the data, total data points, and find out what are beta is, what are alpha is, what are beta h is. This is all there is. It's very standard procedure of fitting and finding the coefficients by fitting data to a polynomial equation. Okay? You do that. These days you don't do it. You go to the software tool and it does it. Or if you want to get a feeling about what is happening, you do it with hand and then check. Okay, so here is your model. Okay? Absolutely no meaning. So here's a model which works, but you have no idea or x1, x2, x1 square, x2 square, etc. These are all squares. And x1 into x3, x1 into x4. But it is a model. It is an algebraic model, like a difference equation model. It's an algebraic expression where the total malaria cases, this is a constant. Then it depends on x1, that is in the TMC at lag 1, with this coefficient. It depends on average temperature with this coefficient. With average, with rainfall, with this coefficient, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So given this, this is all you. There are 15 coefficients, and when you have fit this model to the data point, you have a very good fit. 84% your goodness of it. Okay. So nobody can complain that this is wrong. It's not wrong, it's quite all right, except that you don't know what is going on. You don't have to know as long as it works. Sometimes that's how you work. Okay. Now 15 coefficients, even though it's very good goodness of it, what do you do with it? Now, as I told you, one of the things we do is we try to reduce the model. Do we really require so many terms? Is it really necessary to use so many terms? So we try to reduce the number of terms, but we try to reduce the number of terms in such a way that the goodness of it doesn't change much, because then the model will be bad. Okay? So that is what it is. Here is, I'll tell you step by step how you reduce the model, but here is the reduced model. If you remember the earliest one, so much fewer, there are only 11 quotients, and your R square hasn't changed much. Okay? So how did we do this? So what we did was, we took out, it's quite a standard way of doing, but it's also quite nice. So you take the old model, that is the full model, you take out one term. Okay? Try and fit it and find out the goodness of it. If the goodness of it changes a lot, then you put back that particular term. If it doesn't change too much, you take it away, which means it's not affecting the model function. It's quite a sensible way to do it, and it works. You can see that without changing the goodness of it, you have reduced it from 15 to 11 at least, and they don't look so bad. Now there's x1, x2, x3, x4, linear dependence. Some of them have negative dependence, some of them have positive dependence. Then x1 square, x3 square, x4 square, x2 square is gone, you can see that. And there is these cross terms, okay? Only these few terms are left. So you can see when I said x1, x2 square has gone, x2 was rainfall. So square of rainfall is not making any difference. But x2 has x4 has 340, this is a major kind of this particular coefficient is fairly large. So anyway, you can't say too much about by looking at the coefficients, because some of them, for example, if you are looking at population is 2 to the power 4. Okay? So when you multiply it, all these actually, this term becomes quite important. So just by looking at what I'm trying to say is, just by looking at these values, you don't say much, because each one of them have some kind of a unit which is not equivalent, rainfall unit, temperature unit, temperature at lag 1, etc. All these things have different values. So when they get multiplied, when they are squared, they have different types of values. What this showed you is when this model is used to fit 59 data points, this is how it looks. There are methods so that it gives you these lines here. So the observed total malaria cases is given by the green ellipses, and the predicted from this model is given by the red line. Okay, and what you see is, of course, it looks pretty nice. There are lots of places where it's quite different also, but in general, it looks quite nice. How did we do it? So let's say in August 2003, we knew what the rainfall was, what the average temperature monthly, okay? A monthly average temperature, rainfall, what was the total malaria case in July, then what was the temperature in July, so all that we know. So we put in those values and find out the total malaria cases for August, and that is the data. So that is how you put the data value there. And looks, the reduced model works, but you have to do the AIC, that is the archive case information criteria, to technically say that this is this is a better model than that. So as I mentioned, that AIC is a very standard method of comparing models. It is it measures the relative quality of statistical models for a given set of data. It's the same set of data, and you have two models for it, and you want to know which is better. So what it estimates is the quality of each model relative to the other models, and gives a measure means for model selection. Essentially, whichever has low AIC, that is a better model. This is the expression one calculates. You can see it depends on the number of parameters. It also depends on the number of observations, data points. And this is where the residual for the each observation is given. So when you square the variation from the actual data of the model data, that is what is actually being optimized. It's being, it's kind of making the lower one is better one. So you can see from this expression that the model which will have lower variation residuals, that is going to give you lower value, and lower the AIC, better the model. So it's pretty standard. Anywhere, whenever you're comparing two models which are given for the same set of data, you use this criteria, okay? So when you do it for these two models, the full second order model, then the AIC for Chennai, the same data set I showed you, but I haven't shown you the model. This goes from minus 181 to minus 187 in the reduced model. Here it goes from 749 to 727. Really doesn't matter what is the actual value, because all you need to see whichever is lower. So obviously in this case this is lower, in this case this is lower. Okay, this is negative. So the second order model is better than the full model. It's good for us because it has less number of terms also. So essentially the reduced models are better. Now you have a model which you have determined or developed this model based on 59 data points. Now is the test of your model, whether the rest of the 11 data points can be predicted using this model. And what are the predictions? You need to know the rainfall, temperature, average temperature, temperature at lag one, etc., for the other, those 11 months, which is, these are old historical data, so obviously you know them. So what do? You put those values and calculate, since the last data point you know from here. So you, this is your model prediction, I think, yeah. So this is a predicted TMC is this value, okay, observed is this one. So this predicted TMC you use and you find out what is happening. This is December 2006. You find out what is happening in January 2007, okay, using the last value and the value. You need only one, a lag one value, that's all. So TMC at lag one and average temperature. You put in those values, find out the TMC, and that is going to be your prediction. Use that particular TMC, find out, use these values for that particular month, calculate the TMC for that particular month. Like this, you should be able to predict. These are one-step prediction methods, and you predict it, and what you get is something like this. This is what you get. These are the 11 data points, okay, which were left out of the data set, the last 11 data points. You started with February 2007, which is the last one, which had this much of difference. And you, every time, stepwise, you predict it based on the rainfall and other data. And this is how it looks. Observed total malaria cases and predicted total malaria cases is the red line. Fairly good model, goodness of fit, 84%, can't expect better than this. So from the knowledge of average temperature, rainfall, total malaria cases at previous month, and average temperature of the previous month, this model predicts these total number of malaria cases to be expected here. Luckily, we have the data, so we can match. When you are working real time, then you want to know based on today is what is going to happen tomorrow. So then you can't match unless the disease actually comes up and gives you that kind of value. But this is, you can see that whatever has happened earlier, one has made the model based on the pattern of the data of the earlier time steps and use that to predict the data set for the latest time steps, which was not used for making the model. Okay? So this statistical model is based on data and it's predicting data which was not used for making the model. It's very important to remember that. Okay? So from February to December, it predicts like this. Some of them are very good. Some of them have, you have to have these lines given, what is the 95% confidence interval, etc. These are the confidence intervals. And if your data falls, if your model data and the real data falls within 95% confidence interval, then you're fine. That much you can take, okay? Because these are all statistical models. So this is what I wanted to tell you people, that from this method, you know, this is a completely different method, pretty very useful method, because most of the time people are in all epidemiology department and statistical institutes and where else, places where they make predictive models to predict what is happening, what is going to happen in earlier time, in the next few times, the future time, they use these kinds of things. Now it's very clear that if your data is very, very erratic, so these things don't work on chaotic data, because by definition chaotic time series is unpredictable. It may be predictable in the first few steps, but it is certainly not predictable in long run. That's what the definition is. So they don't work very well for that kind of completely erratic data sets, but it works in many cases. It works, as you can see, that this is a very standard method of doing. Doesn't require too much of knowing how to solve differential equations. Certainly requires you to learn bit of statistics, to understand the quality of data, to understand where data is always not given by God. It's collected by human beings. And there are lots of problems in data collection. That's what we were discussing today. Nobody gives you a clean piece of data. It's only when you collect data, you will take care of it. Nobody gives you anything which is nice and clean. So you have to keep, a lot of people use. So I will just end all my talks, since we are at data, just to tell you that it's, whenever you're working with data, there are lots of problems you have to face. First of all the things that we have done are deterministic models, okay? Now, whenever one is collecting data from the field especially, it is never a deterministic system. There's lots of other factors that are affecting it. We can just club it and say that, okay, there's some noise in the data. But how do you handle it in your analysis? There's this whole area of statistics called Bayesian statistics, which is used a lot in these kinds of predictive modeling studies. Not too many people do Bayesian statistics. You can, of course, go to a software tool and ask it to give you some kind of probability, priors and things like that. But you have to understand the system to decide those things. But those are very good weapons to attack data sets. So you have a model, you want to fit the model parameters from a data set that somebody has given you on after doing some experiment. You don't even know whether you think your model looks good and it should be able to do that. But how do you use the parameters? How do you decide what parameters to use? So a lot of course, nothing can be predicted unless you have some basal information. But all these things people use, methods in Bayesian statistics like Monte Carlo, Markov chains, if you have heard about these words called MCMCs. And so there are more and more, you know, more complex and more involved methods in statistics, in mathematical statistics, in Bayesian probability theory, which are used in data analysis, and especially in disease data analysis. So it is always nice to be a little wide in your understanding, a little wide in your, even if you can't do a Bayesian analysis, you should understand what's going on, because it gives you a much wider understanding of the whole system. Even there are always people who know better than you. There'll always be people who will know better than me. So it's always good to go and ask them, talk to them, take help from them. For example, in this here, all the people we have, Amit Apte does a lot of these MCMCs, and he does data fitting on something else, not on disease. But since the methodology are there, it can be used, okay? So learn from everybody. I mean, since this is the last time I'm giving you these sermons, let me take the advantage of that. There is no end to learning, sorry to say that, but at the end of my life, I realized that there's so little that is we have done over the years, and there's so much more to know, because every day some new techniques are coming up. All these new people who come back after doing their PhD from abroad, they know much more. You should hear Sumit and others. They know so many things. They do such complicated models. I can't even do those things. So there are things coming up, especially in these kinds of areas, which is very important in human health. A lot of different methods of estimating and setting data set or understanding how to fit a model to a data, they are coming up. So whatever you do, doesn't matter, even if you're doing experimental biology or if you're doing pure geometry and topology or algebraic geometry, it doesn't really matter, because nothing stops you from being a very educated human being who understands and keeps information about a lot of other things. This is one area which you can try with simple data sets, handmade data sets, and try and see how it works. I showed you with real data, and I showed you how it works. It's not very difficult to do, but again, we go back to the mathematical biology course. So since we are in mathematical biology course, mathematical models gives you much more insight about how the disease is progressing. So there's no alternative to that. These are methods which you want to use for short-term prediction, because you need to tell people that is the disease going to go up or down. Okay? So they are very useful methods. Half the time you have no understanding about the disease, so you can't write a mathematical method. But this is as good mathematics as solving differential equations. They're just a different class of mathematics, that's all. Okay, so I will stop here. From tomorrow, you will continue to do the lab. But from tomorrow, this one is starting, Dan is starting, and he will do completely different things. It's always good to, these are the only times you would hear all these different things, so please stay and understand and ask him. Today at 5:30, we have a special lecture by Vishwesha Gupta. He is an ecologist, a theorist turned ecologist, and works in a very interesting area. So his models won't be on epidemiology, but will be on ecology. So all of you must be there. Anyway, we are all here to continue into doing the lab. So once he comes, we'll... So please continue to do this. And all these things are taped, and they are all videoed, and they are all kept on the website. So you can, whenever you want, you can take a look. Okay.